This is Duke University.
Danny Briere is the founder and CEO of Telechoice Incorporated, which is focused on the intersection of strategy, telecom, and technology. He is recognized as one of the most creative and innovative telecom strategists in the industry today. He's done a lot in, been quoted regularly in publications ranging from USA Today, the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Financial Times. As well as he's written and edited more books than some people have read in their entire life. So, and still he manages to be involved serving on several nonprofit advisory boards. One in particular, he actually flew in from Connecticut today, and one of the groups that he's involved with, he's a member of the judging staff of the Connecticut Invention Convention, which is a really cool thing that's actually going international, and it's something that promotes inventiveness and thinking outside of the box strategies in children. So, Danny, we appreciate you being here.
Thanks a lot, John.
And look forward to your presentation.
Hello, everyone. I'm sort of a wanderer, so I'll probably wander around here. If you guys have any questions, just shout them out. We've got about, maybe 45 minutes or 50 minutes left here to run through. I've got way too many slides. Cowie's going to throw them up on the web somehow so you guys can see them after the fact. So I'm going to go through a little bit quickly here because there's a lot that I want to try to cover. Also, we've got a great case study of one of Duke's own. They talk about his iPhone application that he launched and how that has been working out for him. So, you know, we're here to talk about web startups, iPhone, Facebook. I've got several startups that I'm doing on my own. And, you know, the first thing I have to say is try to talk you out of it simply because, you know, there are so many people that say, oh, iPhone, everybody's using an iPhone. There's so many applications out there. They're all cool. I'm going to do that too. And, you know, for every single one of these applications that we can talk about, there are a heck of a lot of them out there. You know, I think we'll be talking some tonight about iFart and pullfinger.com and stuff, and the other 200 fart applications that are available on iPhone. You know, for any one you pick, there are dozens out there like that. And so, you know, one of the things that we're going to talk about here is try to broaden your perspective about where you can develop to, where there are opportunities. But a good rule of thumb is simply that if everybody's talking about something, it's usually too late. I mean, let's face it, if everybody's talking about how great and explosive the wireless industry is, it should have gotten in there 6 or 8 years ago. And it's usually a pretty good VC phenomenon. So, you know, why would you do this? I mean, understanding why you're going to get into this is really important because it's going to drive you down different paths. You know, you've got a great idea, you've got a product or service that you're trying to promote, so you've got a revenue stream over here and you're treating it as a marketing channel. You're trying to show off your skills, burn off steam, it's your idea of just having fun. Okay, that's one approach. It seems like just thing that to be doing because everybody else is doing it. You know, hey, what's your iPhone app do? Mine does this. You know, some talk about at parties. But understanding exactly what you're trying to accomplish is really important in the beginning, because if your sole goal is to go out there and make money, okay, I'm going to do this because I'm going to get rich. As you'll see from here, there are other places you may want to do it, okay? So, we're going to talk about lots of different platforms. The iPhone is merely one platform. Now, iPhone, being an app exchange for iPhone, also covers iTouch, pretty soon the Apple TV, pretty soon the tablet. So, you know, got other places you can go there, but it doesn't help you at all on Google Android phones. It doesn't help you at all on Symbian phones. It doesn't help you at all on Yahoo widgets on the TV. You know, understanding where a platform is in its life cycle is really important in trying to figure out where to go. If you're part of the developer gold rush, it's sort of like all the people that went out to California and said, you know, they've struck gold. I'm going to go out there and get gold. Well, the first guy's got a lot of gold. The middle guys and last guys, not so much so. The people that made money there were the people that were selling the hotel rooms and the prostitutes and the beer and the bars and all that sort of stuff. So, Me Too applications and approaches are really, really hard to work. You know, you're going to have a very unique idea here. And not only just a unique idea, but some sort of angle, right? Some sort of end. It's one thing to have a medical application. It's another thing to have your dad be a doctor and a member of the North Carolina School of Medical Trainers or whatever, and has 300 friends that are willing to go ahead and put it into their businesses and start using it. It's better to be first than to be perfect. This is a very much of a land rush mentality. You want to get your stake in the ground, start getting, people love to talk about the first application. They never talk about the second. So marketing, 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 it's all about marketing. Probably a lot of people in this room can whip out an application over a weekend, maybe a week. Even a tough application may take, a couple months, okay? But the real buck is in marketing, getting people to use it. And Ryan's gonna have some real good examples about that. So, you know, so what's hot or what was hot and where are they in their life cycle? You know, Facebook has got a zillion applications. Now, it doesn't mean that you can't have a success out there, right? You look at Zynga's farm application, you know, they went from, the USA Today was saying, 300 people in June to, 56 million as of now. So you can have an application that just takes off. But look how big the company is that built that. And they built an entire social networking environment, you know, around a gaming environment in Facebook. In the same time frame, you probably had about 20 or 30,000 applications that were developed and launched onto Facebook. And you talk to a lot of people that use Facebook, they got a lot of applications, they use hardly any of them. So standing out is very hard at this point. Open social, never really taken off. If you're not familiar with those, open social is an attempt by a lot of the social networking groups to sort of open up their systems and allow people to share applications between them. It's always one of these great concepts and everybody says, yes, we need world peace, but then they go back and they buy about a lot of nuclear weapons. I mean, they never really opened up their applications to anybody else. iPhone applications is now really crowded. Android is just taking off. I mean, Android, I think there's a lot of good opportunity in the Android platform right now. The other platforms like BlackBerry, Palm, et cetera, as I'll be talking about, are more on the downward slant. Widgets are really big. There are issues with widgets coming out, but Yahoo TV widgets, Verizon Fios widgets, getting on the TV set is really a new frontier that's very untapped. And a lot of people are going to get that are early into that marketplace, and still early in that, we'll have some good home runs. Next big thing, gaming platforms are certainly hot, but they're saddled by the fact that they've got a different user interface, and we'll talk about that. Digital books. The Kindle is an absolutely amazing product, not because of what it does. The key thing about the Kindle is that it's the first real product that came bundled with wireless that you have no wireless usage charges for. I mean, everybody hates the fact that they have to buy a different broadband plan for their laptop or one for their car if they want their car to be online or for their little Wi-Fi access point that they carry around with them that's on 3G network or something. These are all extra plans. Kindle, it's all bundled in. So that means that you can deliver a lot of different types of content under an e-commerce model, and the users aren't going to be sitting there saying, oh, I'm running up a bill. I'm going to get this $16,000 bill from AT&T because I traveled to France. You know, that's not going to happen because you're buying a book for $29 and it's built into the price. I think you're going to see that these platforms are going to just really take off when Apple launches its tablet. It's going to be down the same lines. So when you're looking at applications marketplaces, really start to expand your thinking about what's out there. We'll be talking about Apple iTunes, other mobile marketplaces that are available, do some comparisons of the different stores here, and show me the money. It's sort of this is where we're going with the next, say, 20 or 30 minutes of the presentation. So mobility, we're in the age of mobility, right? If you look back at the ages, we had the age of the PC, in the 70s and 80s, you had everything governed by Moore's Law, and how quickly processors were growing and everything, the amount of computing power. Then we went into Metcalfe's law, where you're talking about the number of people on a network and the exponential value that it would gain as more people grew a network, and that was in the 90s, the age of the internet. In the 2000s now, we're in the age of mobility, where we're governed by McGuire's law, which talks about the value of wireless devices. I mean, you'd think, if in a normal business school sense, if you're doing some sort of analysis of the value of a cell phone. Well, we know that a 60-inch plasma TV or LCD TV or OLED TV, even better, you know, will run you $3,000. And if you go down to a 42-inch, well, maybe you're down to $700-$800. If you go down to a 30-inch, maybe down to $400, and you go down smaller, so maybe you go down to a black and white TV, you're down to maybe $79, $69, $59 or so smaller. So a cell phone that's got a 2-inch screen, well, that should only be worth maybe $10, right? Well, bull. People are paying $200, $300, $400, $500, $800 for a cell phone because it provides you mobility, lets you have an instant, always-on access wherever you are, and that's the real value. So we're in an age of mobility, and mobile apps are getting a heck of a lot of the attention right now. But they're not the only game in town, so there are really two groups here. There are places you can put your apps, you can build an app, load it in their system, into their directory, sell it, or offer it for free alongside other ones. And you can read as well as I can right here. And then you've got places that are open to build against. And in this group, there is just a ton of ones. You know, Twitter, Skype, eBay, Google, Eventful are some of the ones that come to mind. But there are a lot more. And then once you get a lot more, there are even more. Okay, so there are a lot of different places out there that you can build apps to. And so what would you do with them? Well, you know, if there's a site out there, there's a really good site out there called Eventbrite. Eventbrite makes it very easy for people to set up an event and sell tickets. Well, they're filling the gap between events that have no tickets and the people that can afford to pay Ticketmaster to do their tickets. So the 80 or 90% of the marketplace is in between. So you're talking about Girl Scouts that are trying to sell tickets to a play. Or you know, the soccer team that's selling tickets to its game or something like that, right? These are people that want to go online, but they don't have to go and go to the bank and set up an online internet account. Well, Eventbrite, how many people are going to know to go to Eventbrite? Well, you use their API and you build something hyper-local, maybe something that's just geared for Durham or around Duke, or something that's only geared for lacrosse players, or something that's only geared for drama clubs or something. You know, you could find that it could take off really fast, and someone else is doing all the work. You're just using their APIs. And so you're charging for their app, they make their money, everybody's happy. So the ability to use APIs and take advantage of someone else's hard work is actually quite attractive. And you can do what's called mashups, where you take different APIs and you put them together. And so you might have the Eventbrite application mashed up with weather.com, so you can see what the weather's going to be like on the day when you go to buy the ticket, whether you want to do the outdoor concert or not. That's a mashup between two APIs. You can mash up 10 APIs together and come up with all sorts of interesting information. So you've got the ability to do APIs or to build your own application. We're going to talk mostly today about building your own application because, well, that was the title we're supposed to talk about. But just recognize that there's a lot of fun in APIs. And APIs you can throw up very quickly. And you can be a lot more innovative and a lot more targeted with what you're trying to do. And I personally think there are a lot more opportunities in that space. So, Apple App Store, they're the 50,000-pound gorilla here. Over 2 billion apps served, more than 75K apps online. Well-developed e-commerce engine. Everybody knows how to use iTunes. Everybody's heard of it. They use this regularly. It feeds into the Apple products. I mean, what a brilliant move. And did they just do that right or not? And so, you know, going into that is certainly quite attractive. But there's BlackBerry and Windows Mobile. They've got greater market share than when you actually look at the deployment of the OS out there. And Android is really coming on strong. I mean, Android is just starting. I mean, it's really the past 3 months that you've really started to see some applications. They've been starting to run some contests to get more people on the Android. Android is Google's mobile operating system, if you didn't know. So Google is just going right at Windows Mobile. It's going right at Symbian, Palm WebOS. And they're going to be very, very powerful just because anything Google does, they can throw so much marketing and so much interesting angles at it, and they're starting to mesh their products so well. They've got a huge educational initiative to try to get all the universities and secondary schools to use Google Apps now going on. It's very, very interesting. So if you want to try to compare some of them, Nokia is committed to Symbian platform, so you can say it represents sort of Nokia. You see there's lots of differences among the different stores, whether you have to pay to be a developer in them, whether they have a phone client available, whether they can do a desktop client as well. Can you use their billing system? What's a billing transport layer? What's the share of the monies? Who's trying to buy off who? You see that
BlackBerry had increased their price from 70 to 80 recently to try to get more developers on board. So, and some of them noticed that some of them have a minimum non-free price, which is sort of interesting that you're starting to see people trying to take it, this and move it up out of the 99 cent per application arena into something more serious. And we'll talk a little bit about pricing shortly. But just walk away from this knowing that there are differences in the contractual opportunities that you have with different operating, with different environments in the mobile environment. Now, when you look at where things are going in terms of downloads, all this is rocking skyward, but the interesting thing is that the paid download is just getting larger and larger. I mean, that was almost minuscule a year ago, a year and a half ago, and now it's just growing tremendously. Oops. And if you look at the number of users who purchased more than one paid app per month, that also was almost minuscule 18 months ago, and now all of a sudden people are just getting used to just buying stuff and downloading stuff. It's so cheap, yeah, what the heck? And so truly this is something that you make up in volume. And so when you look at the size of the marketplaces of the paid application aspect of this, okay, not the free part that may have advertising or other things associated with, but just the people that are paying, you know, it's gone from nothing to over 200 million in roughly 18 months, and it's expected to be a billion. They don't even know when, right? It could be as quick as 3 years. It could be even sooner, depending on how things really take off. It's just amazing at how fast the revenues are going. So people are going to get that. When you just look at the sheer number of apps, you know, WebOS just started to launch. It's either just launched in the past couple days or getting ready to launch. You can see that Android is already up to 10,000, right? I mean, Android didn't even exist a year ago, to a large part. It was still a rumor. And so you've got a tremendous growth there. So when we talk about opportunities and where you can go ahead and apply your time, the angle and the how you're going to get into the marketplace and how you're going to market it really starts to stand out. So when you're looking at where the money goes and where paid apps are almost 20% of the total, heck, with Apple iTunes, you know, they're over $1 billion in revenues, but paid apps are already 20% of that, and more than half of all the downloads from iTunes is associated now with applications for the iTouch. Yeah.
Is that revenue to the developer?
No, that is revenue through to Apple, with which the developers take from 70%. So. Android is the one that people are really looking at because they're pushing the whole, we want to be open, we're going to let everybody do this stuff, putting a lot of pressure on Verizon, Sprint, and AT&T, although Verizon's just saying that they're going open too, and they've cut a big deal with Android. I expect this to be a lot bigger than 18% because Google is just throwing everything they've got at becoming the player in the mobile marketplace, including looking at buying up wireless networks. They're looking at making some acquisitions. The rumor on the street today is that they're looking to buy a CDN player, Akamai, which is a wireline player. But they've been doing all sorts of stuff in the wireless space, talking about ways that they can buy up wireless spectrum in volume. And so I expect that to just go very, very a lot higher. Palm WebOS expected to grow, but still going to be laggard. Windows Mobile. People aren't really excited about. I mean, people aren't, in general aren't excited about Microsoft products these days. iPhone and BlackBerry still going to be good, but we think they're going to really end up trailing Android. And Symbian's going to depend on where some of the big players. I mean, Nokia is saying that they're staying behind Symbian for now. They're not doing Google. I don't think they can afford to do that for very long. So some questions about the platforms that you'd be developing on. Will Apple expand the iPhone OS beyond the iPhone iTouch? Most certainly, right? I mean, it's one of the worst kept secrets they're working on a tablet, and Verizon is probably going to be the one that's going to roll it out first. And, you know, it's just natural that all those applications that are on the iPhone and iTouch are going to roll over to the tablet. The Apple TV 2 has been rumored to be in development for a long time. They keep on saying, oh, we don't believe in this market, right? but it is a huge marketplace. And if you look at their financials, you're seeing a lot of take-up rate of people ordering stuff rather reliably and regularly through iTunes, through the Apple TV interface. And so there's a lot of growth there. I can't believe that they're just going to ignore that. I really expect them to come out with something in the next, you know, probably maybe the Macworld show in January. Will Android grow as big as analysts predict? I think absolutely. You're going to see it embedded in all sorts of stuff. And you know, one of the big areas that is still really underused is what's going to be the OS for the car. We've had a lot of preliminary stuff from BMW, from Ford, from Chrysler, people doing these different experimentations. Ford's doing sync with Microsoft, Chrysler's proprietary, BMW's proprietary. But really what they really want is someone like Android in the car or Apple OS in the car. It's funny that Apple OS is really refusing to license its operating system, which was the same big mistake that Jobs made 20 years ago and why they lost the PC race. And so you've got to argue. I just think they're making the exact same mistake now that they're refusing to license that OS anywhere. And so they're giving a huge marketplace to the Googles of the world to come up and take that from them. Another big area is widgets. How many people know what a widget is? Okay, a lot of people in the room. So basically you've got these widgets are little compartmentalized bits of code that do a very specific thing, that acts as a front end to allow you to do some very specific things like, you know, change your DVR or send some Twitter tweets or to see what your friends at Facebook are doing. And up to now, you've seen these on iGoogle, from MyYahoo, on NetVibes, other places like that. There are no real standards. NetVibes is a startup that's probably got the leading market share in terms of people using a standard on them. But NetVibes, they've tried to put this thing called UWA, Universal Widget Architecture, in place to provide portability. So if I develop something for Google, I can take it to Yahoo, I can take it to Verizon, etc. Hasn't really taken off, and so there's still a lot of proprietary platforms that you got to develop to. But Yahoo widgets now are showing up on the TV set. You've got widgets that are built into the TV sets, into Blu-ray players, into the PS3, the Wii. You've got all sorts of emerging opportunities in set-top boxes. Netflix is actually probably one of the most unheralded opportunities to do application programming to. They're just about to open up their platform to application. They've had it open to selected third parties. Now they're getting ready to open it up to have anybody go and program to it that wants to get on the TV set. They've been really waiting to nail down the high definition applications really well, but Netflix is a good opportunity that I probably should have mentioned a little bit more here. The thing about widgets, though, is they're not really designed for monetization. They're really designed for advertising or to grab people and take them to the place that is being monetized. So if you've got a website, you've got a plan for a website, and you're trying to get more people to come there, widgets are a great way to do that. And so you'd offer limited functionality or teaser functionality in the widget to allow people to come on in. We sort of expect that that's going to change, though, because there's no reason why widgets shouldn't be 99 cents also if they've got value, if they actually do something. And if people have a platform that they want a widget on, if you've got a TV set and it supports Yahoo widgets, and you want the Boston Red Sox widget because you're a big Boston Red Sox fan, then you can be guaranteed that the Red Sox are going to try to charge you, well, they probably charge you $2.99, although this year it's probably at a discount given the way they play. So, you know, what's a widget look like? Well, here's a Yahoo TV widget, Flickr widget that's on the TV set that you pull up and you can go back to your Yahoo widgets there. But as you can see, it's a shortcut into all your photographs at Flickr. And with Verizon, here's a good idea for how you can take a peek into what everybody else is watching. And so you can socially watch TV with other people. You can also tweet while you're watching TV. You know, let them know you're watching Bolt with the Kiddos, which is so key. You've got other platforms like the WiiWare, okay? So you've got like 80 platforms that are there. You know, they're making some good money there. A lot of people are going towards health applications. There's a lot of women-oriented applications that are coming up on there. largely a big player space there because you've got a pretty hefty developer application you have to fill out to really show that you're a real going concern. So, it's okay, enough of this business stuff. I wanted to make sure you guys understood that it's not all about the iPhone. There's other stuff out there. And where they are in their life cycle is important for how you're going to monetize this, if you're in this for monetization. So, where to develop? Well, for consumer apps, you know, Apple really is the default choice, but you're swimming in a huge pond, right? And there are a lot of players. So the number one thing you have to ask yourself is how the heck are you going to stand out of a crowd of 100,000 by the time you go up there? And chances are there are a dozen other players that are doing your same idea. It's very hard to come up with something that's totally unique in that respect. So if you've got something that's got just absolutely phenomenal press appeal on it, that the media will just be all over, and Oprah will want to talk about it, or David Letterman or something like that, then that's a great idea. And those things, you can get one that pops up a week, that someone comes up with something that's really unique, that is just really cool, right? That people just go, wow, I would use that, right? And that's what they say, that, you know, this is something that I would use. For business apps, there's really a transition going on here because BlackBerry and Windows Mobile have been the most deployed, but I think represent in a lot of ways the least opportunity because business apps tend to move slower, especially if you're talking about enterprises that are trying to make a commitment across company-wide. So you're going with individual preferences, but a lot of that depends on who they're linked to, what they're linked to in terms of databases within the enterprise. Android is got just a lot of visibility these days, and people are enamored with the idea that Google's coming in and taking over the space, and the people just love to get on a rising entity. Widgets are all in place, but I mentioned they're rarely monetized. If you're serious, you're going to largely go down one of two ways. I think I may actually say this on the next slide. I'll say that a little bit later. So if you're serious, you're probably developing a multi-platform strategy. You'll do it on Facebook and MySpace, and you may do some mashups with some other external APIs, and you're making a commitment to a single idea across a very broad way, and you're going to focus on marketing that application. Or you're going to just quick throw a bunch of stuff out there. You know, I'll create 20 applications and hope one gets some traction. Sort of like the way a VC would approach that. So if you're considering building your own app, you can either build it yourself or hire someone to do it for you. So building it yourself, the pros, you got a lot of control, you can be really reactionary to customer needs, you can be opportunistic and just say, I'm going to do something over the weekend. Oh, that's really great. But it can be slower to marketplace because it may take a long time to go through the approvals because you don't really know how to get the approvals tweaked and really sort of speak their speak and get the stuff through as quickly as possible. And let's face it, some of the bigger players get their apps through a lot faster simply because they've got the relationships. They've got 100 applications that are in queue on behalf of their customers, and they're talking to them daily, and you know they've got it down. They may even have someone dedicated to them to push those applications on through it. So you can go out there and hire people that range from the garage shops all the way up to the big programming resources. The garage shop probably run you $6,000 to $8,000 for an application. An outsourcer, you know, $15,000 to $25,000. I've seen them as much as $50,000 for really complex ones. They'll usually give you a guaranteed price, they'll give you a guaranteed date, and they'll help you through the whole approval process and take responsibility for that. Problem is that there are a lot of people out there that say, oh, I can do an iPhone app, you know? And then they'll even show you some, but you know, you don't really know what it took to get that application in the marketplace. And so the market has been flooded with people that claim that they do all sorts of social networking applications, and it's tough to find some good ones. So, some lessons learned, some things to think about. You're not going to build your masterpiece the first time through. If you want to take time to make sure that it's got some pretty good traction and it works pretty well and run it by your friends and that sort of stuff, obviously. But it's better to ship a little late and get it right, because if you ship junk, you know, people just trash it and you'll get so many negative reviews. It's hard to recover from that. You almost have to change the name and just relaunch the whole thing in a different application. It's also very frustrating because you can go in there and think you've got the best app, and someone else has the same app, a different way. They get all the traction, you don't, because they hit the right nerve, they called it the right thing. I mean, it's funny how you see applications that people just, they can say the name easier, or it sounded cuter, or it was funnier, or whatever, and it just sort of caught on. So be prepared to have to react and iterate a lot. I mean, even, I'll give some examples later on about how different people have gotten caught in this review cycle. You can hear that, so different applications have got different requirements. I can write a Facebook application and not get it reviewed by anybody, make it go live. It won't be in the directory, it won't be officially certified by them, but I can get people using it without any permissions. They can always come and shut me down if it's screwing something up, but I can launch one. You can't really do that with an iPhone. An iPhone, they'll give you a couple of developer codes that allows you to have some people go ahead and selectively use the application before formal launch, but you have to go through their approval process, and you can wait months, and then they'll come back and say, oh, you forgot to dot this, throw it back at you, and then you have to go right back into the same approval cycle, and it can seem arbitrary. You've probably seen all sorts of articles about this. All those articles are absolutely true. So, you know, you want to, everything about you want, and everything about the web says, you create it, you throw it up there, and boom, it's available, and you're going great. It's really a lot harder to actually pull that off when you have to go through an approval cycle. So, you know, is this all about the $100 bills or not? If you want to make money on your application, you know, it's really going to depend on what your angle in the marketplace is, what your positioning is. The idea alone doesn't carry you. You've got to have some sort of in, some sort of deployment, some way to get this above the chafe. And there's a reason why people keep on buying the top 10 apps, because they're on a list, and so this is what everybody's buying. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy, because people just keep on buying what everybody else is buying, and they check those out. So getting on that list is really the key. Cheap apps obviously sell best, but not all stores will let you price that low. We talked about how some of them had a $2.99 limit. But people will spend a lot of money for this stuff. I've always laughed when people say, oh, well, no one will spend $90 for that. They will if there's value. I mean, people will spend money if there's value. People are spending amazing money on things these days. They'll do it with value. You can use a free version to get in and then get people to add. One of the big things that a lot of people do, they give you a free app or a game to play, but then they sell you virtual goods on top of this. Like, oh, you want a bigger sword so you really win? Well, you know, that'll cost you a buck. So, final thing about technology-wise, if you build something for one platform, expect to wholly have to redo it for another platform, right? So, it's going to be a totally new application. You're going to have to do that all in a probably different code, different platform, and maintain them side by side as it goes through different iterations. So, first to market is not as important as first in marketing. So, we had to sum this up. I'm going to try skipping through here a little bit faster. We talked about how customers find the applications that are at the top of the list faster than everybody else. I mean, people don't really go with brand names. They don't really go with news articles and stuff. They tend to buy stuff that's right there in the application that people are talking about, that people are on the list. So these are all fairly self-explanatory. Just recognize that you know, this isn't something that you're going to invest in. You have to keep up. These platforms are changing rather fast. People are coming out with other applications. People are announcing other features. I mean, there's all sorts of, there's a cute video coming up here that will really underscore this. So here are a bunch of URLs for developer programs and people like that that you can go and find out more information on the various places and the great widget design platform there at the bottom. And so now I'm going to turn it over to Ryan Kaminsky, who's going to take you in the blow-by-blow of an iPhone development application that he's gone ahead and done. I'll tell you about that. And then we'll come back and I'll show you a few more things, and then we'll take questions.
Would everyone hear me okay? I don't have a mic. So I'm Ryan Kaminsky. I'm a second-year MBA student and also a developer. Just out of curiosity, are most people here developers? Can you raise your hand if you're developing, you want to develop an app? Okay, so I have my developer outfit on today rather than my business outfit.
Hey, Ryan, let's go ahead and mic it.
Oh, okay. Next caller. Where is this one?
Just so everybody knows, there's a sheet on Ryan. It's the Business Week sheet, and it talks about an article that was written about him and his iPhone app.
Thanks. So I'll probably reiterate a lot of the stuff that Danny said, and the parts where we disagree, I go with what he said. So just to cover the basics real quick, I'm sure probably most of you know this. You need a Mac to develop the iPhone. You can hack your PC, and I've seen some people do some tricks, but I don't know how to do that. So I didn't have one, so I had to borrow my brother's, and one of these days he'll realize it's missing. So and the second thing, you need a good idea, or not necessarily. So here's a video from The Daily Show. I'm sure some of you have seen this.
I want to start it over.
And now, Eric Stratton versus Joel Kahn.
What did you create?
I created the iPhone application, Pull My Finger. Pull My Finger is an application that makes bodily noises.
Bodily noises.
Fart noises. It was at its highest point, the number two application in the entire iTunes store.
Pull My Finger was bringing in under $10,000 a day. Until internet mogul Joel Kahn entered the market.
We originally got the idea for iFart in the late summer of 2008.
With the power of his dominant application company, Infomedia, iFart quickly knocked Pull My Finger off the top of the charts.
iFart's a superior product because of the utility features that are built into the application, such as security fart, sneak attack, fart a friend, second word we have a variety of sound.
That ripped me off. We were the little guy. All right. That got crushed by.
You guys can watch the rest.
You gotta keep playing.
It's
you gotta play the rest.
All right. What the customer wants.
That simply didn't want to play by the rules.
We sold more than they did, and they wanted to blame somebody for it.
His press releases would have hot links in the press release that would say, "Pull My Finger." Only it would take you to his application, iFart.
We were using a commonly held phrase that's been in the public domain. In fact, at this point, the Pull My Finger phrase has not received approval on a trademark.
So you're trying to trademark the phrase, Pull My Finger?
Yes. Pull My Finger's attorneys sent a cease and desist letter to iFart's attorneys.
Pull My Finger and iFart have attorneys.
New attorneys,
yes.
Jewish attorneys?
No idea.
So you're not sure that they're real attorneys.
And it'll take everything those attorneys have to take on the power and experience of Joel Kahn.
So you're like the Walmart of iPhone applications.
We've made a number of applications. We developed some applications for celebrities like MC Hammer. It's called the Hammer Time app. It's a way for Hammer's fans to keep up with his concert events and his blog and his Twitter feed.
So it's essentially like a suicide watch for us.
This is a fight for more than just a trademark. He wants recognition for opening the door to so many, like the makers of Fart Piano, Fart Shaker Deluxe, and the over 200 other fart apps.
The rest of the guys may have never made it in the store if we wouldn't have done what we did. I would describe Pull My Finger as a pioneer, much like Jackie Robinson did in baseball. Yeah, absolutely.
Jackie Robinson integrated baseball.
Right.
So you're comparing fart applications to a man pioneering civil rights.
We are iPhone applications to someone pioneering a different industry.
Civil rights. But civil rights, because what he did was open the door for more minorities to integrate the game of baseball.
Well, in that sense, yes, we opened the door for more mom and pop applications.
I see exactly what your struggle is. You shall overcome.
For bigotry and intolerance, Eric Stratton soldiers on.
I'm not stopping now. We had the idea where you can light your own fart.
That makes sense.
Forever courageous, forever the pioneer.
I should just end the presentation there.
Here it is, your moment.
Whoops.
I ask unanimous consent that the House rise for a moment of silence to recognize those who will lose their jobs.
So I think that demonstrates, you know, you don't really know what's going to be a hit, and give the customers what they want, right? So you have a choice in developing the app, like as Danny mentioned, you can outsource it or you can do it yourself. And but these first three steps are really the only first step. The second is marketing, as Danny spoke about as well. And just real quick, if you have any questions, feel free to interrupt me, and I'm going to try to make this somewhat interactive. So when I was thinking about developing the app, one of the things you want to do is think about the opportunity, the market size, right? Is there a need for this? Is this really a pain point that the customer has? So when you think about the, I haven't talked about my app, Tom. So it says in the, I developed an application to help people apply for their MBA and manage their applications. So in this market, you have to think about, well, how many people are applying for their MBA? There's not that many. I've done some research, it's about 200,000, if we're lucky. And so of those, how many have an iPhone? And then of those, how many would actually buy? So these are the types of things you need to think about when you're market sizing. But there could be some other considerations, and if you're looking for a niche product. For example, the MBA network is very strong, and that's one of the main reasons people get their MBA, is for this network. And also, MBAs are not really price sensitive, because we spend like $100,000 to go to school, so you know, another $5, $10 doesn't really matter. And this third point here, like where else can it lead? So that now that I developed this app, I have a lot of credibility in this domain, so I'm getting a lot of contact from these other people that want applications developed in a similar type of fashion. So now that I've done one thing, I have this opportunity to do other things because of this application. And then, you know, you might want to make it because it's fun. So when I wanted to develop the app, my first goal was to get something out there really fast. But as Danny said, it can't be crap, right? So you have this dilemma between getting out quickly but making sure that it's not going to be a bomb, because if the first customer interaction with your product is horrible, then you're pretty much done. And it's really difficult to recover. But one of the things you can do is get something out there and then get feedback from your customers so then you can go and improve it. And Apple provides a really great platform for making updates to your application. You can do this somewhat quickly, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. So here's my application. I try to keep it simple, and so basically you just keep track of what schools you're applying to. You can look at some of the top schools, get basic information on it, and then it has the application requirements like the essay questions and what else is required for the application. So the approval process is something that I really stressed out about. I read a lot on forums, these horror stories of it taking so long, and you have to go back and forth. So if there's one thing wrong, you have to resubmit to Apple, and then it takes like another 5 to 7 days or whatever. So now with this graphic over here, they say that 95% of applications are approved within 14 days. It doesn't sound like that when you look at the forums, but I guess the people that are having the least luck are the ones more likely to talk about it. But there's a few things that I did to try to ensure that. And so one quick question, like, has anybody not had an app crash on them when they've used one on their iPhone? Yeah, so Apple really doesn't consider this too much, I think, as long as it runs the first few times. Again, but you don't want a bad customer impression. So there's actually a few bugs in my application. Don't tell anybody, but they don't appear until you've used it for like 20 minutes. And so I figured probably 99% of the customers won't ever use it continuously for that time. So it really didn't make sense for me to go to try to fix them at that point when I submitted the app. So the approval process is getting much longer, as you would imagine, as the number of applications in the store ramps up. And I think they're scaling okay, It used to be 7 days for approval. Now it's 14, so who knows what it might be in the future. And some of the things that you need to think about for approval are definitely look at the Apple UI guidelines. If you misuse a button in the way it's not intended, your app will be rejected just for that. So there's this blue cross button. If your user presses it and it doesn't take you to the contact list on your iPhone, your app will be rejected for that. So another big issue is copyright content issues. They want to make sure you own the content, and whether it's pictures, images, words, or whatever. I was really concerned about this because I used the actual questions that schools have on their application. This was my main concern, but I got through, so maybe someone didn't do their job that day or something. But I don't know who owns that. Error checking, this is especially true when you're going out to the web and making web calls. They're very concerned that you check that the phone is connected. They'll reject it even if you don't check for this. And look on the forums for help. People post why their app was rejected, so this is a good resource. So how do you price your app? You know, it seems like almost every app is 99 cents on the store. So what I did is I hired a pricing consultant to conduct focus group and price sensitivity analysis. Not really. I just picked a price. I figured MBAs, like I mentioned, they're not that price sensitive, so they'll be willing to pay more than the 99 cents, but how much more? And there's some other considerations. So I looked at the other business apps, which is where I placed the main category of my app. And generally, those are actually priced a little bit higher than the games, if you take a look at that. So I figured I was okay pricing higher. And also, I wanted to have more sales initially to try to get the buzz going. So I priced it probably a little bit lower than I should have. So my price was $1.99, which I think should have been higher. But I had fairly strong sales for what it was. So I priced it $1.99. So now that I released the app, I had to try to figure out how to get it in front of people. And I know this sounds obvious that you need to get your app in front of people, but you really do. That's like the number one driver of sales. Them seeing the icon on iTunes or somewhere is really what drives sales. And especially with a niche application like this, and where I don't have a high marketing budget. So the first thing I did was I posted it on Facebook, and I asked my MBA friends to forward the link, because everyone who's in an MBA knows people applying for their MBA because of the really strong network. So that really aligned with the strategy of my application. So that's one thing you should think about when you're trying to market it. So I also posted, and I don't know, you know, if you're supposed to do this, but I posted in Business Week forums. I felt a bit sketchy about doing it, but it worked out really well because I was contacted by the Cambridge MBA program director there, and he wanted to be in the app. And so I thought whether I should ask to charge him, but I decided to just put him in there anyway. And so he is helping promote the app as well because they got in there. And I was also contacted by some other people in the industry. So it was a great way to kind of build this network. So one really important thing, when you get your app out there, it's placed on the home page of your category. So for me in business, when people go to the business category, the icon is actually on the page, which is a great driver of sales. And so the bad part about this, though, is that you have no control over this. It really depends on how many other apps are submitted and approved that day. And then your app will get pushed off and onto the next screen. And then, you know, as with Google search results, nobody ever goes onto the next few pages. So another way to help stay on the front page is to do frequent updates, because whenever you update, you're put back on the front page. And so my strongest sales were when I made an update to add international schools and some other features. And so I think a really great example of this is this Pocket God application. Has anybody heard of this one? No. So I've been watching them for a while, mainly because a friend of mine thought of this idea, and he's kicking himself that he didn't do it. So they started out a very basic application, and they only had 2 stars in the rating. But they kept updating it every week. This was back when Apple could approve it weekly. Every week they added a new feature. So it kept getting on the page of games. More people kept buying it. It kept gaining this momentum. So it's like this flywheel. And so now it's been in the top 50 for like, it must be like 9 months now. It's like ridiculous. It was number 1 for a month, I think. And so really, I think the update, the model that they use of updating frequently was really beneficial to them. So another good way is to make a light version. People really love free stuff. And I made a light version of my application. But an issue here, I didn't design my light application the correct way because I was so worried about the approval process. I submitted the light version right after I submitted my regular app. And so I didn't have a few things which I would include now, such as people can't actually download my app from the light version because I didn't know the URL for it yet. So if they wanted to, it was like a call to action that is missing from my app. And I didn't think about the best way to showcase the value of it in the light version. So I would take a bit more time to think about that when you're doing that. And again, the light app gets on the home page there and gets your app in front of people. And so my light app was downloaded like 150 times the first day. I didn't think there was that many MBAs. But people just download it anyway because they just like free stuff. And I don't know if people, there's an email today, so Apple now is allowing in-app purchases, applications. It's allowing applications that are free to have in-app purchases now, which kind of will start at the end of the light version of applications, because now you can just have your application and then people can upgrade within it and they can pay the money then. But I think light versions will be around for a little bit longer. Okay, so now that I created my app and, you know, some people are buying it, I marketed it mostly through Facebook, and I'm gaining a little bit of momentum. So what should I do now? Does anybody have any thoughts? What would you do in this situation? You can yell it out. Nobody?
You're looking for free ideas.
No, well, I'll tell you what I did, but I want to see. All right, well, I can put some Google Ads up there, right? So I did that, and I got very specific words, such as like MBA iPhone app, which I think people would be interested in the app if they're targeting that. Question?
What about contacting career services at a bunch of universities, right?
Yeah, so I tried to do that as well, with no luck.
Yeah.
Did you look at selling a site license to the business schools and just sell it to them, you know, $1,000 and applicants can download it straight from their admissions page?
No, I didn't, but I will now. So what I did was I tried to find a partner. So there was a few companies I had in mind just based on my experiences of applying for an MBA. So one company I contacted, another company actually contacted me. And so I had to actually choose between these two companies. So one company was an MBA admissions consulting company. And another was an MBA admissions podcasting company. So quite different, but so each had its benefits and drawbacks. I was wondering if you, what do you guys think? Which one should I pick?
Consulting.
The podcasting is podcast, wider audience.
Yeah.
Podcast.
All right, you guys are divided.
Why can't you do both?
They both wanted exclusive rights to it.
Yeah.
And I felt I wasn't in a huge bargaining position given that, you know, I'm just a guy making an app.
You're the only app, though.
Yeah, I don't know if the market could support another app, was what I was thinking also. Yeah, but they both wanted exclusive rights, and that wasn't a negotiation issue. So my thinking was the consulting company can add some real value to the app because the number one issue for MBA applicants are the essay questions. And so the consulting company can do analysis of the essay questions and I can add that to the app. And also I felt like people going to consulting sites were willing to spend. And also I felt the podcasting company, one good issue there was people already were familiar with iTunes and had an iTunes account, so it would be easy to download. But their main draw was going to be mentioning it in the podcast. And I felt like people weren't going to be ready to purchase at that point because they're kind of passive listening to the podcast while they're actually going to the consulting site and looking for information. So I ended up picking ClearAdmit, who is a top MBA admissions consulting company. And so I rebranded the app as them, mainly by changing the colors. And adding a splash screen, but other features are coming. And we raised the price to $399 from my $199. I got a better logo because everybody said they hated my old logo, which is probably because a friend made it for me. And so they're doing the marketing and promoting on their site. And so just one quick interesting point. So my old app is still there because ClearAdmit released it under them now. But I wanted to update my app one more time because the schools are very slow in updating the application information. Even Fuqua's really slow at it. So I raised the price to $19.99 to not compete with this app. But I sold four of them last week. So maybe I priced it way too low to begin with. So don't tell ClearAdmit, by the way. So I got some press recently this week. After I've been trying to contact Business Week for a while, they finally contacted me. And there was an article about business school applications, iPhone applications, and so I'm featured in there. And so one lesson from this, be really careful about what you say. Otherwise, you have some really dumb quotes in an article. And so when we released the app, we broke the top 100 on the business page right there. We got to number 90, maybe higher, but like it changes frequently, so I didn't keep watch of it the whole time. So things are going pretty good. And so, yeah, so I mentioned I've been contacted by several industry-related companies looking for work now that I supposedly have credibility. And I got to speak to you guys. So thanks. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. And if you know anyone applying for an MBA that has an iPhone, contact me and I'll see if I can get some free codes from ClearAdmit. So I guess Danny will finish up now.
So in the spirit of doing the two-minute app, I'll show you what my latest project is on these same lines, and then we'll open it up for questions. We feel there's a marketplace among the universities to go back to the roots of Facebook. Facebook really does not handle university applications and school applications very well at all. The whole idea of being able to build coursework, of groups that can have individualized applications, really isn't there. So we've built a standalone application that actually resolves one single problem that most keeps schools from adopting Facebook, and that is that teachers don't want to friend their students. Right? Teachers want to have their groups, and students want to have their groups, and never the twain shall be. It's like having your parents in your group. It's like, ooh, gross. You know? So the other thing is that Google's making a big push into the education space. And Google doesn't have real strong social networking arrangements. So what we've done is created a Facebook application that has been rolled out University of Connecticut. First, we've got three other universities that are working with us to develop this. And that bridges Facebook and Google. And also provide students with a consolidated and layered calendaring, classmates, and communications model where students can not only find out what's going on in their calendar, they can say, well, show me the basketball calendar, I show me a consolidated calendar of all my classes, all my deadlines, so what are my friends doing this weekend. So there's a calendar application here that, you know, typical calendar application. Then there's a classmates area where you've got three different organizations. You've got the ability to do stuff by courses, by various communities that you may be involved with, and various organizations that you may be involved with. And so each of these comes with their own little app store, where we're developing applications, and we'll be having an applications program, where you've got basically left-hand navigation here for modules that are specific. So courses are more likely to have like a course map and study groups and assignments. Whereas sports teams might have equipment rental and music places might have recital room checkout and things like that. And so I could have a community here where maybe I've got a learning community in my university where it's built around knowing when the next guest stars are coming or next prospective student tours and other things like that. It's a bi-directional loop so that one of the big problems that a lot of the university communications have is that they tell students something, give them an alert, there's no way for them to know if they ever got it. And a lot of times these reside on a website, and people don't know to go there because something popped up. As a matter of fact, in the high school, there's this teacher that's infamous for posting things at 9 o'clock at night to see if her students catch it, and then she yelled at them the next day. It's very, very evil. But the bottom line is that people can say that they've actually received an alert. You can see a checklist of everything. So the idea here is that you've got the best of Facebook, you've got the best of Google applications and calendaring wrapped up in one tool, and so we're rolling this out starting, goes to alpha on November 30th, and with refined rollout throughout the spring for very major national push at the beginning of the following school year in both secondary education and to the university marketplace. And anybody's interested in working on that, let me know. So with that, we'll throw this floor open to questions for Ryan. Ryan, you want to come back on up here? And if you guys have any questions about any of this, by all means, let us know. If you have technical questions, ask him.
Since we're over time, maybe we'll take like four questions and limit it there.
Three and a half.
Yeah.
How do you maintain competitive advantage in some where development time is pretty small and it's pretty easy to replicate these kind of things?
So, a lot of marketing. I mean, it comes down to that. That's what the marketing function is. And this question was, how do you maintain competitive advantage when people are constantly coming out with new stuff? You got to stay close to your customers, and you got to constantly innovate, right? I mean, the guy blowing, you know, striking the match and blowing the fart in there. I mean, how many ways can you reinvent a fart application? They're coming up with ways, right? And so things that get them back on the agenda. I think there's a life cycle of certain applications where there's not much more you can do with them, and you just got to do another application. And so having more, the reason why I developed mine in the way I did is because we can have innovation by bringing on new modules and addressing new groups and adding in ticket sales, and we're doing stuff with Ticketmaster and other things like that. So just constantly throw more in there and talk to people and build your base, and becomes insurmountable if you're in there first. There's actually another player in our space but they're doing what I call a top-down model, where they're trying to sell administrations and IT departments. Says, let us interface with all your systems and integrate them all together and launch this great thing for students. I'm like, yeah, 10 years, you know, it'll take forever. We're doing a bottom-up where no systems have to be involved for anybody to get started. So it comes down to sort of like what you're trying to accomplish. We've got this is a big system we're doing. A little application, no offense, but a little application, right? You know, there's, like you said, there's probably room for one of those. But if you do an exclusive deal, which my friend's got this great little speech that goes something like, I've already got one exclusive relationship, that's my wife, you know, I don't need another one in my life. It's something you can expand that, but the bottom line is don't do an exclusive relationship ever. Well, you know, there's this, I mean, the guys that get left out are just going to go and develop an application on their own and compete. So, in any case, I don't know if I fully answered your question, but you just got to innovate and then market the heck out of it. I mean, it's not easy. I mean, there are a lot of applications out there. I mean, for all the applications you've heard of, you can name 10, right? The other 75,000 you've never heard of. Any other questions? Gosh, you know, the problem is it's going to depend on the application, right? I mean, like, for instance, you know, take the MBA application. I would think going where the MBA people that are actively trying to do admissions, which is going to be the admission pages themselves of the MBA programs, or the Business Week MBA rankings, or those articles themselves are the best place to market. Being in newsletters, putting in ads, all that other stuff is probably totally worthless for his application. But if you're trying to do something more generic, that's more cross-marketplace, where you're just trying to get people interested, like the flight simulator application that they've been running on the iPhone, that's been enormously successful. There you could be advertised anywhere. You could advertise on Google, you could advertise on Facebook, you could advertise on any of the gaming channels, and you're just trying to get a spontaneous point of purchase type of thing. So, you know, it's a very tough, generic question to answer.
But what are you planning for your products?
Well, so for our application, there's one publication that we're going to target, which is Campus Technology Magazine. One posting in there, one article in there, and all of a sudden everybody's involved in Campus Technology. We're about that. But we're not really trying to sell the universities. We're trying to sell the students at the universities and teachers at the universities who are looking for solutions, and it'll go viral from there. And so we figure if we've got a number of colleges to start this out, it's not going to be long before it's a viral strategy. But we do have the key influencers nailed down. We know which ones talk about this technology, which bloggers, which people speak and give webcasts. There's only a handful. So we've got like six people that we need to influence. We influence them. Pretty much everybody in the world's educational institutions know about it. So we're sort of lucky in that respect. Yeah.
On the campus application, like in what way can I interact with a student at another school through the application?
So the question there is, so ours is geared around classmates and interactions at that university, okay? They're classmates, they're not necessarily friends, but you can friend any classmate, right? And so there are organizations that will span universities that go beyond what we call them supergroups. So an example might be National Merit Scholars or whatever, you know, they're some in every school or whatever. So the National Merit Scholar Organization would want to have a chapter at each place, but they could go across different chapters. It wasn't really designed to try to just be, let every student talk to every student. But what we're finding, and particularly for your application, which is very interesting, I'd love to talk to you, is that a phenomenal number. So 25% of freshman year students on average in the nation's colleges drop out after the first year. Amazing number. And so there are entire groups within the universities called the first year experience group, FYE groups, whose job is dedicated to try to reduce that number. And one of their big applications is, we want to get people to stay because we want to be able to link people with like interests and get them together so that they very quickly have some sort of bonding relationship at the university and make them more prone to stay. And so they're looking for applications that match people up. But they need it within their closed campus environment. And see, this is where Facebook is lousy. Facebook is, they can create a group, they create a network, but it doesn't mean anything. You can't really do anything within the Facebook environment. Yeah, in the back.
My question's for Ryan.
You can only ask a half question, though.
Last question, yeah.
When did you start working on it, and did you have any experience beforehand, or what was the learning curve like in the development?
Yeah, so I used to be a developer at Microsoft, so I've only worked with Microsoft technologies, which is why I didn't have a Mac. the learning curve at first was actually quite a bit. There's some really good resources online. There's Stanford had a course, and they posted the videos on iTunes. So I looked at a lot of those. That's a really great resource. And there's a lot of sample code online that you can look for. But Objective-C is really weird. So it took a little bit to ramp up, but it's actually, now that I know it, it's fairly easy to create nice looking apps quickly now.
All right, well, with that, Joe.
Yeah, let's give these guys a round of applause.